Good morning and welcome to King's Christian Centre here in Mold. As you can see, I'm not in the church this morning. I am recording this at home, but nonetheless, I just wanted to share with you that today is Remembrance Sunday, a day we set aside in the calendar, a very important day to remember all those who gave their lives in all of the conflicts that this country has endured and willingly gave up their lives so that we might enjoy freedom. More of that later. But first, a really well-known hymn, O God, our help in ages past. And let's join in and sing this together. Today we remember those who gave their lives to for their country and for their culture, to uphold the law of freedom right across the whole world against the terror and the overcoming forces of evil. And we just want to say thank you to all of those people who gave their lives willingly so that we might live in our country free. In 1940 and 1941, 1.5 million men, predominantly, were enlisted into the Home Guard to prepare themselves ready for an invasion. And we pay tribute to those men who, many retired people, many older men who maybe couldn't fight on the front. They got together and prepared, ready to withstand the invasion that we believed was coming in between 1940 and 1941. And we just want to say thank you to them, along with all of the other military personnel from all the services that gave their lives. And we just want to honour them with valour, with honour, with thanksgiving. And we want to remember them by saying that really well-known epitaph to them. They shall not grow old as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn, at the going down of the sun and in the morning. We will remember them. So following on from that act of remembrance, let's join in with a great hymn of thanksgiving and praise. Great is thy faithfulness, O God my Father, there is no shadow of turning with thee. You know, all through the wars, many people came to church and prayed that we would have success and victory. And God, who is faithful, gave us the victory. And he's ultimately given us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. So I hope and pray that you remember God's faithfulness to us as a nation when we called on him in our time of need. So let's sing this hymn together.
Thank you.
So following on from that great hymn of praise, great is thy faithfulness, let's bow our heads in prayer, shall we, and thank God for all that he has done. Father of all, we ask you to remember your holy promise and look with love on all your people, living and departed. On this day, we especially ask that you would hold forever all who have suffered during war, those who returned scarred by warfare, and those who waited anxiously at home, and those who returned wounded and disillusioned, those who mourned, and those communities that were diminished and suffered loss. Remember too those who acted with kindly compassion, those who bravely risked their own lives for their comrades, and those who in the aftermath of war worked tirelessly for a more peaceful world. As you remember them, remember us, O Lord. Grant us peace in our time and a longing for the day when people of every language, race and nation will be brought into the unity of Christ's kingdom. This we ask in the name of the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We'll say together, if that's okay with you, the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Well, it really is good to open God's word, isn't it, and to share together in the parables that we've been looking at over the past few months. And today, a really well-known parable, the parable of the 10 virgins, found for us in Matthew 25, 1 through 13. And in a moment we'll read that. And the joy of having this parable on such a momentous day as Remembrance Sunday is that all of those troops who went to fight for our country, all of those men who were enlisted into the Home Guard, they were ready. Now they may have only undergone basic training, but they were ready. They were ready to fight. They were ready to give up their lives. They were ready. And Jesus asks us, are we ready? Are we ready for his coming, for his return? And many of us, well, we're not quite as ready as we could be. And it's a bit of a challenge to us, living, yes, for the moment, living right now, seeing God's kingdom come, wanting to see the gospel spread, wanting to see the church renewed and filled, not only with the Holy Spirit, but filled with real people, but also living with that sense of preparedness and readiness for Jesus' imminent return. So it creates a bit of a tension, a dichotomy. Those two things running in parallel, living right now, but being ready for his coming. So let's read the text for today, shall we? I will be looking down at my laptop, so if my eyes go away from the screen, please forgive me. But I will be just making sure that I'm reading the correct words. And this is from the New Living Translation of the Bible. Then the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 bridesmaids who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. The 5 who were foolish didn't take enough oil for their lamps, but the other 5 were wise enough to take along extra oil. When the bridegroom was delayed, they all became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight, they were roused by the shout, "Look, the bridegroom is coming. Come out and meet him." All the bridesmaids got up and prepared their lamps. Then the 5 foolish ones asked the others, "Please give us some of your oil because our lamps are going out." But the others replied, "We don't have enough for all of us. Go to a shop and buy some for yourselves." But while they were gone to buy oil, the bridegroom came. Then those who were ready went in with him to the marriage feast, and the door was locked. Later, when the other 5 bridesmaids returned, they stood outside calling, "Lord, Lord, open the door for us." But he called back, "Believe me, I don't know you. So you too must keep watch, for you do not know the day or the hour of my return. You know, with many early Christian interpreters of this parable, some today continue to understand it as an allegory, whereby Jesus is the bridegroom, echoing the Old Testament image of God as the bridegroom in Jeremiah chapter 2 and verse 2, and in other places too. Jeremiah 2 verse 2 says, "I remember the devotion of your youth, how as a bride you loved me and followed me through the wilderness, through a land not sown. Israel was holy to the Lord, the first fruits of his harvest. All who devoured her were held guilty, and disaster overtook them, declares the Lord." The awaited event, of course, is the second coming of Jesus. The Prince of Wales was on a visit to a home in the Midlands and dropped into a workingman's home. Next day, the man told his friends, "I never expected him, nor did my wife. The house was untidy, and I hadn't washed. We shall never forgive ourselves. If we had known he was coming, we should have been ready for him." John Wesley was once asked what he would do if he knew his Lord would return at that time the next day. He said, "I would go to bed and go to sleep, wake up in the morning and go on with my work, for I would want him to find me doing what he had appointed." That is the way we're supposed to live and prepare for the future. There's a balance in the Christian life between knowing that Christ might come back tomorrow, but at the same time living as if he may not come back in our lifetime. If we go off on one extreme or the other, we end up with problems. For example, in 1 Thessalonians 4 and 5, Paul wrote that the Lord's return was near. So the Christians in Thessalonica should live with that in mind. Apparently, some of them thought that since the Lord's coming was so near, they could leave their jobs, sit at home, fasting and praying and watching the sky for the clouds to be rolled back like a scroll. Well, Paul heard about this and so wrote his second letter to the Thessalonians to tell them that although the Lord's return was near and they need to live in light of that, they must also live as if his coming was far off. We must be laying foundations and fighting the good fight of faith for future generations. Somebody famous once said, "Stay alert as if the Lord will come tomorrow, but prepare as if he will not come in your lifetime." This is the lesson of Matthew 24, and it teaches us the idea of being alert and ready. We must always hold on to a sense of the imminent return of Jesus Christ. He could return tonight or tomorrow. Are you ready? So let's unpack this parable that we've been reading about. Who are these virgins? Well, we know from Jewish culture that the wedding celebration was for the whole town. One of the acts of entertainment was to have 10 virgins perform a wedding dance around the bride and the groom. They would hold lamps or torches and perform a torch dance. It would symbolize the light of their love and the bright future they had together. They would dance for the entertainment of the guests and wedding party. They would dance until their torches burned out. So these 10 virgins are part of the wedding celebration after the wedding ceremony and the wedding supper. This is who the parable is about, these dancing virgins. But this is a parable. Each member of the parable represents someone or something in real life. So who do these virgins represent? Well, let's deal with the easy one first. The bridegroom is obviously Jesus. In such parables, the bridegroom is always Christ. Secondly, we know there is a bride. If there's a bridegroom, there has to be a bride, doesn't there? She is not actually mentioned in this parable, but every bridegroom must have a bride. And as the bridegroom is always a picture of Christ, the bride is always a picture of the church. The bride represents the church, and the church is made up of all those people, whether Jews or Gentiles, who have believed in Jesus Christ for eternal life. These virgins then represent those who are invited to the wedding feast, yet 5 are unprepared for the imminent arrival of the bridegroom, and some, of course, are ready for his coming. Well, 3 surprises await us here. Firstly, only half were ready to enter into the festivities that day. It tells us that it is all too possible to be in church and in Christian company and yet be a stranger to the Holy Spirit. You have no oil. It is possible to have a lamp that looks good, but has no oil in it. Secondly, it's a surprise to discover that there are simply some things you cannot borrow. You need to possess them for yourselves. It's not possible to rely on anyone else for them. Holiness is one of those things, being made right with God. It cannot be traded. And if you are not what you profess to be, nobody else can help you or stand for you. The bridegroom will come, and it will be too late. Thirdly, there are times when, sadly, it's just too late. Too late are terrible words to hear. The examination is today, and you have not prepared. It's too late. Time to get ready and to be sure you don't miss the party. This is what Jesus means. Readiness is the key. The state of preparedness is the whole point of the story. Will your faith find you working diligently for the Lord, doing what he's asked you to do, sharing his love with others, sacrificing yourself on behalf of the kingdom, kept picking up your cross daily and following after Jesus, remaining vigilant and watchful, ready for Jesus' return? Do we believe he's coming back? Well, I believe he's coming back. Do we know when? Well, the Bible tells us that only God the Father knows when, so don't be fooled by listening to other people and them telling you that they know when it is, because they don't. Nobody knows except God. And as this is the biggest secret ever, we are to be ever watchful and waiting. So let me ask you again, are you ready for Jesus to return today, this hour, this very minute? If he comes back and the shout goes out, Jesus is here, what would he find you doing? My prayer is that the five ready and prepared virgins, you will be invited in to the wedding feast, because you will be ready. My prayer too is that you will not be like the five unprepared virgins who missed out because they were not ready. Which group will you be in? Will you be ready for the coming of the King? Are you ready? Is your lamp full of oil? Are you brimming over with the Holy Spirit? Do you know Jesus today personally? If you're really honest, strip away all the veneer. Come on, let's get real. Do you know Jesus today? Really know him? Not know about him, know him personally. I pray that you do. You know, there's a way that you can know Jesus. There's a way that you can be ready for his return, and that's by putting your faith and your trust in him. That's very simple to do. And we're going to listen to a very poignant song in just a moment, which says, which picks up John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. You know, if you're not sure about whether you know Jesus or not, well, that's probably a verse to turn to. John 3, chapter 3, verse 16. And Jesus explains that those people who trust and believe in him will be saved. Perhaps you want to know more. Well, get in touch and we'd love to help you. But right now, let's just listen to this song and rejoice that we are ready for his coming. God bless you.
For God so loved the world,
come on,
that he gave his only Son, and whosoever believes will not perish, they shall have eternal life.
We believe in God.
I shall hold to the cross. I shall hold to God alone, for his love has
and salvaged me, for his love has set me free.
For God.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, and whosoever believes will not perish, they shall have eternal life.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
I shall wait upon the Lord, and I shall wait upon his word, and by his grace I am released, and by his grace I am redeemed. Oh, for God.
Well, thank you ever so much for joining us this morning. We hope and pray that on this Remembrance Sunday, you've been able to share in that remembrance, but also that you've heard the word of God about being ready. We're so grateful to all those service personnel who were ready to go and fight for their country. We're ready. We're so grateful too to our Lord Jesus, who was ready to give up his life for us. And I hope and pray that we will be ready when he comes back. So thank you so much for being with us. We hope and pray that you will be blessed through this week. If there's anything we can do to help you, please do get in touch with us. And we wish you every blessing through the coming days. May the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen.